In this video, I'm going to show you my home assistant setup, looking at my add-ons, interfaces, and automations. Make sure you stick around, and if you like what you see, make sure you hit subscribe below so you don't miss out on future videos. Hi, I'm Will from Will Surridge Tech, and today I'm going to show you my Home Assistant. Often in tutorials, people will show you a Home Assistant instance different to their usual one, to keep things clear. But I want to show you the real deal. We're going to look at the hardware I use, some software, some add-ons, the device I have integrated, and some automations that I have set up. If you're new to Home Assistant, make sure you check out my video, What is Home Assistant, linked above. If you stick around till the end, I'm going to show you how you can add any web page into your sidebar. Remember, anything I mention will be listed in the description below. So starting with the hardware, I'm running my Home Assistant on a Raspberry Pi 3B Plus with a 64GB microSD card. It's hardwired directly into my router for faster connection. Now you may have seen in my smart home tour that I keep it in a little pot to keep the dust off. Don't call me a cheapskate, but it is cheaper than getting a real case. Now let's have a look at the software. Before I go any further, I should mention that Home Assistant is configured using a language called YAML. YAML is very particular about spacing, but other than that, it's really easy to read and follow. So this is my main configuration file. I try to label things as soon as I add them to this file, but for these first two, I'm not really sure what they mean. Home Assistant and Front End. I'm guessing it has something to do with customization and themes, but I'm not entirely sure. If I'm likely to have more than one item in a specific section, then I'll try to use a separate file and reference it here in the bottom of my configuration file. So the main integrations in my config are Hacks, the Home Assistant Community Store. This is a great place to get extra add-ons and integrations from the community. A remote for my IR blaster. iOS to integrate with the app. Evo Home to connect to my heating. Tuya for my smart plugs. Google Calendars to integrate some of my calendars. Dark Sky for the weather. Philips Hue, and the Browser Mod. Now the Browser Mod is a great add-on from the community which has loads of beautiful features. Now if we look at some of my subfolders. In Sensors we have a system monitor for the status of my Pi, the bank so I can check my balance, the date and time which is really useful in automations, and lots of template sensors. Now these are great for getting one thing and outputting it as something else. For example, I'm using the template sensors to obtain the temperature from a climate state and then output it just as the temperature. In cameras, I'm integrating my front door camera using its RTSP feed. In scripts, I'm connecting my Philips Hue scenes to a script, so when I trigger a script, it triggers the scene. In media player, I'm integrating my Fire TV, some Spotify accounts, and my Philips TV. This one uses a custom component. In device tracker, I'm listing a few methods that I can use to track devices. I'm using a network mapper for all devices in the home. I'm using Google and Tile to track my phone when I'm outside the home. Any devices detected by a device tracker will be listed in the known devices file where you can customize them, for example, renaming or assigning icons. In the input section, you can create your own selectable devices. For example, a Boolean to trigger an automation, a scale to select a number, or a drop-down list for maybe rooms in the house, perhaps. In lights, I'm integrating my Magic Home LED drivers and my Ambilight TV. This means it treats the Ambilight TV as a light bulb, so I don't need the TV to be on. Under Switch, I've listed all the IR commands for my IR blaster, so I can use them to create a button to control the TV. And lastly, Scenes. I've only created one scene. If you're looking to make more complicated scenes, then you're better off using Node-RED. But for just a simple scene that only involves lights, this is a great place to do it. Now onto the main part of the setup, the Lovelace. Lovelace is what they call the user interface. You have two options for editing your Lovelace. You either use the built-in editor, which is much easier to use, but quite limiting in terms of what you can achieve, or you edit the raw YAML like I do. As with my config, I like to split my YAML up into the different views that I'm going to create. But in my main YAML file, I have anything that might apply to multiple different views. The first is resources. This is where you can link to custom components. If you use the hack store, it's really easy to use these. You just click install and copy and paste the two lines of code directly into your resources section. There may be some components that aren't in the hack store, so you'll need to download them and save them directly into your files. Next, I have some decluttering templates. These are really useful if you're going to use the same card with the same settings and the same style multiple times. Here I have some for my simple layout with the code from Isabella Alstrom, and some for my floor plan with code from Luke Vink. After this we have custom header. This is good for editing the header of your Lovelace screen. I'm using it so Flori only has access to tabs that are ready to use and not ones I'm still working on. Now let's move on to the views. First of all we have lighting. This was a quick interface that I created to replace the Philips Hue app. We have each room in a separate vertical stacking card. We have a paper buttons row for quick scene selection. Each room has an overall control using the Hue group. And then using a fold entities, we can select each individual light, clicking on it to change the color. Moving on, we have a very simple heating setup, again designed to replace the Honeywell app. This is using the standard thermostat card, and then I've also added a heating boost automation. You select the room you want to boost in, how long you want to boost for, it'll tell you what time that boost will finish, and you click boost. That will heat the room to 21 degrees for that length of time. Next, we have the simple interface that you will have seen before. It displays the calendar, the temperature, the weather, gives me access to the heating boost, and control over the music. If guest mode is on, it will also pop up Wi-Fi details for them to log in. This is based on Isabella Alstrom's code and design. This is my network overview screen. It tells me all the devices that are connected or not connected to my network, gives me maintenance information such as battery level, and also shows me my Raspberry Pi information and my network speeds. This is just a list of all my automations with an override switch for each one. And lastly, we have the floor plan. Using the code from Luke Vink, I've created an overview of my house. It'll change throughout the day depending on the height of the sun, and of course if a light is on, the room will light up. I'm wanting to also implement other controls such as media players and heating into this interface. Now we've had a look at some interfaces, let's have a look at some add-ons. You can find these under the Supervisor tab. First of all, we have a file editor, which is really useful as a fail-safe way to edit your files. Next up, we have Samba Share, so you can edit your files from your computer and share your files across the network. Next, we have a terminal. This means you don't have to SSH in all the time, or if you're accessing remotely where you can't. Speaking of remote access, I use DuckDNS so I can access my Home Assistant from outside my network. We have a configuration checker. This is really useful to check your configuration is correct and will work with the latest version of Home Assistant before you update. I use Mosquito Broker for my MQTT, ESP Home for any homemade devices that have an ESP chip, and of course Node-RED for my automations. As you can see, there are loads more add-ons that you can get depending on the kit you have and what you want to achieve. Let's start off looking at hacks. This is a great place to find integrations that aren't official, for example the Ambilight TV or the Browser Mod. There are also plugins, which are basically cards for Lovelace. Generally speaking, I will find these mentioned in other people's codes or even posted about in forums, and then I'll go to hacks and search for them. Then I can use them myself. If you want your Lovelace to do something specific, then it's likely that someone will have created a card for it and posted it here in hacks, for example the Xiaomi vacuum card or the Reddit card. Also in hacks you can find other people's themes. I don't really use themes myself, but they're a really good way to change the overall look of your interface. Next up, we have ESP Home. This is where you can implement your homemade devices into Home Assistant. It makes all the code for you, so it's quick and easy to flash and get them integrated. If you want to learn more about this add-on and see it in action, then check out my video linked above, where I set up a WS2812B digital LED strip with a Wemos D1 Mini. Before we go into Node-RED and have a look at some automations, I want to tell you the kind of devices that I have integrated into my Home Assistant. I've got 16 Philips Hue light bulbs with 5 smart switches. I know, Paul Hibbert wouldn't be impressed. I've got 2 TP-Link HS100 smart plugs, 6 Tekin smart plugs, 6 Evo Home thermostatic radiator valves, 3 cheap RGB LED drivers, 2 Wemos D1 Minis, 2 Neos cameras, 5 Echo devices, a Google Home Mini, 4 Sonos devices, and a Broadlink RM Pro. Maybe Paul will forgive me. In terms of other entities, I've got my calendars and to-do lists integrated, I've got device trackers for anything that's been on the network, some scripts and inputs that I've created, as well as a lot of switches for my Broadlink. Now onto automations. This is my Node-RED. First we have a flow that backs up Hasio to Google Drive every week. Now we're onto the big one, my sleep scene. When I trigger this, it turns everything I don't need off, turns the bedroom to a dim light, stops all the music throughout the house, but then plays a sleep playlist in the bedroom on a low volume. It gradually dims and turns off the lights over 15 minutes to help me go to sleep gently. In lighting, we have a simple automation that turns on the LED strip in the kitchen overnight. I find this stops the slugs getting in. In heating, we have all the heating turning off at midnight. This means I'm not heating the house overnight when it's not needed. I also have the heating boost, which you'll have seen in my Lovelace. And I've got my outdoor timer. So when the heater outdoors is on, it just shuts off after an hour, so I can't accidentally leave it on. In iOS, I have a few notifications that I haven't got around to finishing, and I have some widgets on my phone for easy access triggering. And there we go. That's my Home Assistant. I said I'd show you how to add a web page to your sidebar, so here we go. As you can see, I've got my router config page in my sidebar. I often find I need to edit DHCP addresses or things like that whilst I'm playing around with my Home Assistant, so it's much easier for me to have it here rather than having to constantly open a new tab. What we're going to need to do is add a panel iframe. I've listed mine in a separate document, but you can list yours straight into your configuration file if you prefer. We're going to need to give it a name and a title, an icon if we wish, and the URL that it's going to go to. I also have mine requiring admin so it's not clogging up Flory's feed. If you liked what you saw today, make sure you hit subscribe below so you can find out more about my tech, how you can set up your own and build yourself the ultimate smart home.